The schedule it is mentioned as insolvency. Insolvency is a huge subject. Since 1920, it is dragging on. But entire insolvency and bankruptcy code, as a retailers, it's not applicable to us because most of the action has to be done by banks and financial institutions. So our role is limited as a company and as operational creditors. When the demand comes, our role is limited. Anyone from here has passed IBBA exam as a RPB exam, resolution professional exam? No, if not, then kindly appear this very lucrative career. Why I say this? Because there is a case recently, a case in Hyderabad, a company called Madhukan Engineers. It's a big construction company, some 30,000, 40,000 crore company. So that company owes some another company around 4.5 crores, 4.16 crores, a Bombay-based company. So that company unable to pay, so they invoked the provisions of insolvency. And NCLT Hyderabad has admitted that application, and IRP has been appointed. Remember, the outstanding due was 4.16 crores. Imagine what is the RP professional, IRP professional who has raised a bill, the invoice. It's 16.5 crores. To resolve a outstanding debt of 4.16 crores, the RP has raised, then the company went, the shareholders went to the NCLT. Then NCLT has stated that matter went to IBBA. IBBA finally has to suspend that professional for 1 year. That professional is also from Bombay. So this is the, as a legal professionals, persons, a chartered accountants, anyone, there's a very huge scope for this, huge scope as a RP, resolution professionals under IBC, and there's an online exam, anyone can appear this, is a good look at. With these notes, I'll tell the importance, why is importance of IBC. It is almost 2 years. November 30, 2016, it was enforced, notified. Since then, around 1,200 cases of insolvencies has been admitted under various NCLTs. Out of this, 57 cases has been approved under resolution process. So it means that management has been changed under 57 cases. And rest of the 212 cases went into liquidation. So this is the background. And so what all we going to discuss here, this is applicability, who can invoke, the process of invocation, and how to, as a retailer, how we need to minimize our risk. Because we retailers have thousands of vendors, a big company like Future Group, More or even DMart must be having some thousands of vendors. So all these vendors will come under the definition of operational creditors. So before we go into the details, this is the background of the IBC. It is not that IBC is not there earlier, it is there. Even in some states, the Provisional Insolvency Act 1920 is there. But only difference from that act and this act is, there is a change, there is a lot of powers has been given under the IBC. Earlier it was only a creditor has to go to the civil court, a district court, file an application. When admitted, then his assets will be taken over and disposed of. It's more or less of a civil nature. But here, the process is different. There is a different mechanism. You have a utility companies, you have a knowledge sharing, is a bank, a financial institution, NCLT, then you have appellate tribunal, then you have Supreme Court. So before coming that, the same provisions were there under Companies Act. Companies Act 433, 434, the winding up provisions were there. And Sikh Industrial, SICAN 85, the same provisions were there. And thereafter, recovery of debt due to banks and financial institutions, we call as a DRT. So DRT, same provisions are there. But SURFACE, you have SURFACE, it is a improvised version of DRTs. SURFACE may assets can also be taken, and management control can also be taken. But all these acts were not as effective as insolvency because of various reasons. So what are the entities which applicable here? Currently, it's only companies. The act, the code currently applicable only to companies. It was not yet notified to the partnerships and individuals. It is going to come very shortly. Then, who has to invoke the proceedings? Who had to start the proceedings? One is banks, one who gives loans to us. So we are not going to discuss that. And second is your operational creditors. As I said earlier, your trade vendors, your service providers, even employees. An employee due is more than 1 lakh. Of course, it's not applicable for our companies, but as a general rule, if it is more than 1 lakh, an employee can also invoke these provisions. And recently, this Unitech case, Supreme Court has also, there is a given direction to the government based on that act is amended. And even the home buyer is also come under the definition of financial creditor. Then third one is the company itself. The company itself feels that doesn't want to continue the business and is liability exceeds his assets, and they want to wind up, they want to liquidate, they can also submit an application for resolution process. So this is a textbook definition of operational creditor, but generally in our terminology, whoever supplies, our vendors, our housekeeping agencies, our security guards, manpower services, the all people come under the definition. Whoever renders any kind of services or whoever supply any goods, these are our operational creditors. Here, these operational creditors, especially, again, we can, this is a supplementary act, the MSME. MSME also overlaps here. MSME also operational creditors, you need to take a declaration. Now the latest act, you need to notify in your balance sheet, you need to file half-yearly returns. So a lot of changes is coming. Now we are not going to discuss about the MSME. We'll be limiting to the operational creditor under IBC. So the first threshold is minimum 1 lakh, and there should be a debt, and the debt arised on account of supply of goods or supply of services or on account of employment. So what happened first? If your due is more than 1 lakh and it is not paid, then first step of IBC. Then what happened? If your due is there, then if you sit, it's not happen. It's not going to happen. Then you need to raise a demand notice. You need to issue a demand notice. We'll get lot of mails, lot of letters. Are all these notices can be termed as a demand notice? The answer is no. Because adjudication rules, the rules annexed to the IBC clearly says that demand notice has to be issued in form 3. There is a specified form as form 3. Demand notice has to be issued in that particular form only. And it has to be sent through registered post or speed post. Or all companies have an email ID under MCA21, your company details. There they can send it directly. You have a CFO or any other person who is a KMP, they can send it to directly. The moment it's sent, it's a demand notice. This is there as per the act. Then what the corporate debtor? Corporate debtor means the company who received this kind of notice. Because we companies, we receive a lot of notices because somewhere amount is not paid or it is paid, some reconciliation problem. We'll get a lot of letters and all. So first two issues address where we need to send and whom need to send. If it is sent a store somewhere situated in Siliguri, it's not been, or he sent a mail, it is not a demand notice under IBC. So once you receive a notice, you have to respond within 10 days. Under Companies Act, you have a 21 days time. Within 21 days time, you need to reply. But here is a 10 days. 10 days, mandatory days, it has to be replied within 10 days. So how the notice is considered? The form 3 says that there is a specified format. They need to mention all the details. And also, if not the specified form, they also need to enclose an invoice. We call a debit note. So the similar debit note they need to raise. Along with that, they also need to submit a banker statement from the bank saying that these amount for example, X company amount has not been credited in last 3 months or 6 months. So 6 months statement has a certificate, not because statement runs into thousands of pages, they need to take a certificate and also enclose the certificate along with the demand notice in the form of Form 3. So who can issue the notice? This was a matter that went up to Supreme Court, because under the Act, it says that the corporate debt, the operational creditor shall deliver the notice at corporate debtor. It says that it has delivered the notice. So in case of this smart city Kochi, a law firm, just law firm of Kochi, they issued a demand notice on behalf of their client. Then the matter went to NCLT. NCLT said that no, it is not. NCLT has admitted the case, but the opposite party, Synergy Properties, they have contested the matter. And they contested the matter, then NCLT says that it is very much, no, they are rejected. NCLT has rejected the application. Then the matter went to NCLT. NCLT said that they admitted. Against this, Smart City Kochi, they went to Supreme Court. Supreme Court has said that because the language, the intent of the Act is, yes, operational creditor has to deliver, but they have taken a reference under the Form 3. Form 3, it is clearly mentioned that operational creditor or authorized person. So they have taken a interpretation that authorized person may also includes your client, includes the law firm. Same case was also happened in Shilpi Gables. That also matter went to Supreme Court. Supreme Court has taken the same stand. So in now earlier, it's only the company has to issue the demand notice. Now anyone can issue the demand notice. So some companies, what they do, they have given lot of security deposits to landlords for opening a retail stores. This is a case of a retail company. They have given a big property. They have given 10 lakhs as a security deposit. Some of the property was not had handed over. They invoke the provisions of IBC. Then matter went to NCLT. NCLT, whether it's a debt or it's a security deposit, but there's a difference between both. Then NCLT said that, I'm not telling the name of the NCLT. NCLT said that, yes, it's a debt. Then matter went to Delhi Appellate Tribunal. Appellate Tribunal said, no, it's not a debt. It's only a security deposit. So security deposit is different and your debt is different. Accordingly, the provision will not come effect. So this related, because we retailers give lot of security deposit for the properties being taken on lease. Thereafter, either they will not hand over the property, we will not able to proceed with the properties. So we may not take much help from this particular case. So what happens when the notice, demand notice has been served to you, then we need to act within 10 days. Within 10 days, what action we need to do? First easy thing, if anything is there, pay it, close it, there ends the matter. Or else, then you need to communicate whether any dispute arises earlier. If dispute arises because of any quality of goods, because of any inferior services, or any breach of warranty. It can be anything. So this has to be, this pre-existence of dispute must be prior to the receipt of the notice. There are cases where after the receipt of the notice, dispute has been created, a dispute has been raised that has been not been considered. The pre-existence of the debt. So Act says that, here also matter went up to the Supreme, because this code itself is new, every section, every meaning, it is going to the Supreme Court and they are giving the clarity or interpretation on this. Here in the case of Sony, there was a Sony TV, there was a program called Nach Baliye. So they have appointed two software firms. The moment we want to make a call to vote, so there are two companies basically. One is they have taken the lease lines, and second is they operate the software. So these are the two companies. The company A engaged a company B, this Mobilix engaged Krusa software, where Krusa software works the back end on the voting. So there is a dispute between them. The dispute is that Crusasoft Mobile Links has to pay 25 lakhs to the Crusa software. They issued a demand notice. The matter went to the Bombay, NCLT Bombay. NCLT Bombay, then they have taken a dispute. They said that no dispute is there. Court said that as per the act, dispute includes a suit for arbitration or civil suit. In the act itself said dispute includes a suit filed for arbitration or civil suit. So NCLT said that this is not a dispute because no case is being filed in the court or before the arbitration. So it is not that. Then finally it went to NCLT, finally Supreme Court. Supreme Court said that this company has supported, Crusa Software has supported some of the emails where showing that there is a non-disclosure agreement. They have breached the non-disclosure agreement. Against that breach, this company has sent a mail. You have breached this non-disclosure agreement. You are not supposed to disclose this. You have disclosed this. They have sent a simple email. And accordingly, we are withholding this payment. That email, Supreme Court has taken into the cognizance and said that this is a dispute, pre-existence of dispute. So as a retailer, we'll get a lot of letters, invoices, demands. So while replying this letter, you should be very careful. As here, there are very many other cases. The dispute letter has been sent. It's very vague. We deny your obligations. We total. We did your allegations are misconceived. So normal legal language will return. It's not that. If we are getting a demand notice, we are really, if any vendor payment notice or invoice we are getting, clearly mention whether any shortfall or any inferiority service or any breach of contract or anything not satisfied. You simply raise a dispute. Even if a dispute is not there, you write 10 letters, say you are not supplied so and so goods, whatever that is. You create a dispute, then it will not go to the NCLT. And we have, this has to be done much prior to the receipt of the Form 3, that is a statutory notice. So after, what happens, for example, if there is no dispute and you are not paid and you are not even considered this, then after expiry of 10 days, then the operational creditor has a right or duty to file before the NCLT for insolvency process. Then the NCLT is adjudicating authority. Within 14 days of receipt of the notice, either it has to admit the application or reject the application. There's within 14 days. Initial one year, that is 2016 end to 2017 end, lot of without notices, matter has been taken by NCLT. But now all NCLTs, before admitting the application, they are issuing notices to the corporate debtor. The other side, they are issuing the notices. Suppose once is the application is admitted, then the entire process has to be completed within six months, 180 days. In exemption cases, it can be extended for another 90 days. So matter has to be resolved within 270 days. There is no extension. If the matter has been not been resolved within 270 days, then the company will go into the liquidation. The simple straight thing. So far 212 companies has been gone into a liquidation. So what happened, these 270 days, what will happen, the picture 270? The moment your application accepted, entire company transactions will be moratorium. Your bank accounts, your all the, except your electricity, basic essentials to survive the company, that will be there. Rest of the thing, it will be ceased to exist. The publication, a notice will be published in the newspapers that so-and-so company has been admitted for resolution and so-and-so a person has been appointed as interim resolution professional, and anyone who have a claims against the company, they need to submit the claims. Once the moratorium happens, then no action lies. The recent case from Bombay went where the company has taken a loan from, and there was a state financial corporation, the special act. The special act accorded the assent of the president, and under that 1 year moratorium has been given. During this 1 year period, another financial creditor has filed a case, and matter again went to Supreme Court. Supreme Court says that IBC supersedes all laws. So the moment within 180 days, it is M1C is accepted. The first and foremost, your board will cease to exist. Board will be suspended. Entire management has to report to RP. And a public announcement, then this RP will call for the COC, Committee of Creditors. Committee of Creditors, those who finance, he'll call everyone. Remember, operational creditor doesn't have any position in COC, he's only a mere spectator. But the banks and finance, even the application filed by operational creditor for non-payment of dues, when the application is admitted, all banks, if any banks are there, everyone has to come and they need to form a committee and they need to appoint the board. That board will, COC board, that board will operate the business and they'll continue the business. And any change, any decision has to be done by the COC. And they, again, there will be different banks or different financial institutions, whoever having 75% voting power in terms of their financial borrowings, in the financial lendings, they have the right to decide. If they decide, they'll call for outside expression, they'll call expression of interest, other persons will come, other companies will bid, and they will participate. If materialized, there will be a change in management, otherwise the companies go into liquidation. So the urgency and the importance as a retailer, what we see, we have so many vendors, and all our transactions are naturally more than a lakh. So how to address? We should be very careful. So we sensitized our internal team that whenever any loan, whenever any due is there, if it is more than certain period, whatever the due date, increase the due date. So the concerned team, buying team said, no, we can't increase the credit period. But if possible, increase the credit period, what we suggested, whenever it comes, whenever anything can act immediately, especially the small retailers, the small service providers, they are very, because I know one company, the security services providing, the amount was 80,000. So it is pending since last 2 years. The company has not paid because there was some theft case against that one of the security guard. The company has not resolved, so they withhold the payment. So this person, 80,000, he added another 50,000 towards interest and cost, created 130, and filed a case in NCLT. Finally, that has to be settled. Because once the matter is, if it is a listed company, then you need to inform your stock exchange, and you have a lot of other obligations. Ultimately, your stock price will come, other risks, what risk it is shown yet in the earlier time, this cyber security, that kind of risk will be entangled with this kind of procedure. So as a law officers, as a legal team members, what we suggest our other teams, especially your finance team or your payments team, whatever the nomenclature we call, the moment any invoice comes, honor it with, because I'm sure all these corporates will abide the agreements. There is no question that we'll not pay. So first thing, address it. Otherwise, communicate the deficiencies and list out the evidences. In case any Form 3 or any notices come, submit this. This is the case dispute, then you are not liable to pay. Thank you. Yes, please. Sorry? Sorry, I could not get you. Mike.
Whether the parties by contract can waive their right to go to the NCLT?
No. It's not like if you put a jurisdiction of Delhi or Bombay, I have to come in Mumbai. Suppose my corporate office is in, say, Hyderabad or in Mumbai. Where my corporate office is there, which ROC I'll come, I need to file there.
So that is jurisdiction. My point is, in a contract, while entering into the contract with the service provider, operational creditor, who is going to be operational creditor, there is a specific clause we will agree stating that whatever it may be, we will go to only to the arbitration. We will not invoke NCLT. Specific clause we will put.
No, it is overheads. See, I'm saying that innovative industries versus ICICI. It is clearly mentioned that it has to be addressed under Maharashtra State Financial Corporation Act. All disputes has to be under this act. It was clearly mentioned that. But ICICI has challenged that. Under 230, it has an overriding effect. It will override everything. It has to go to LT only. Even if you put arbitration or any other redressal mechanism, it has to go to NCLT.
Themselves will go to an arbitration, will go to an IBC. They will not invoke an IBC provision. Whether that is allowed, that is what
no,
I think.
No, Section 28 of Contract Act. Section 28
yeah,
of Contract Act.
In restraint of, no, no, here it is not an agreement of restraint of a legal proceeding. It is agreement in restraint of specific this proceedings under IBC.
No, Pankaj,
you can do anything else, but not IBC. That is what he is trying to say.
No, I understood because he says we want to protect the company interest. But he may sign at the day one, he may sign. But after a dispute or you want to go to the, we can't stop. Why? Because this supersedes every other act. This it was a private contract. Ours is a private law, the public law will always prevail. Thank you.
Will the law of limitation apply then?
Sorry?
Law of limitation will apply to this because you say
yes. Last October 16th or October 17th, October in the month of October, Bharat institution case is clearly said because in MSME cases there are certain judgments there, law of limitation will not applicable. Madras High Court says that law of limitation will not applicable in MSME. Some other high courts is different, but under IBC, the matters went in the case of Bharat institution. If you Google, you'll get. Supreme Court clearly said law of limitation will applicable for IBC.
So that means any overdue more than 3 years, I
Gone.
Believe that's the
law. Yes. Thank you.